I'm Keith Halliday. Welcome to the Yukonomist series of political interviews on the Northwestel Community Channel in the run-up to this fall's territorial election. I'll be speaking to the leaders of the Yukon's four political parties about what they and their parties have planned for us if they win the election, and also to a series of key opinion formers in Whitehorse and around the Yukon on the issues that are important to them in the upcoming vote. First on today's episode is Sandy Silver, leader of the Yukon Liberal Party. Hi, Sandy. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me, Keith.
For those of you who don't know Sandy, he's originally from Antigonish, Nova Scotia. He's got degrees in math and psychology from St. Francis Xavier University in Nova Scotia and a degree in education from the University of Maine. He moved to the Yukon in 1998. He's been a school teacher in Dawson and also president of the Dawson City Music Festival, volunteered often as basketball and badminton coach and music instructor, among many other volunteer activities. And of course, he's been an MLA since 2011. Now, Sandy, the election's coming up, of course. What do you think the biggest two or three issues facing the Yukon are in this election campaign?
I think there's three, really. There's the environment, there's the economy, and there's also relations with First Nations. And we don't look at those as separate issues. We look at them as all being tied together. If you wanted to discuss them as individual things, on the economy, we're looking at cutting business taxes, and we're looking at focusing on diversifying the economy and also improving the relationships with First Nations so that our mining industry can prosper. If you take a look at the environment, we want to protect the Peel. We want to say no to fracking. We also want to have accurate data when it comes to greenhouse emissions. And we also want to do more money and more funding for retrofits. If you take a look at the First Nations relationships, we need to revive the Yukon Forum. We also need to work with our partners in Ottawa to make sure that the S6 is repealed. And also, we want to make sure that we honor our commitment to the treaties. So if you take a look at all of those three things, it's hard to put them in silos. Every time you make one of these bullet points, they affect each of those three topics.
Let's talk about the economy for a minute now. Every election that I can remember since I was a little kid, which unfortunately is a lot of them, people have been talking about diversifying the economy as well as supporting the resource sector. So what would you do differently to actually move the needle on diversifying the economy?
Well, right now we're really concerned about how the current government does their procurement. We're seeing a lot of ramping up of spending during an election cycle. In the last 2 years, that ramping up came as a real issue to our surplus, to our piggy bank. We've seen the Yukon Party government take a surplus of $225 million and drain it down to about $57 million. So when you're buying the hearts and minds of Yukoners with your own money, that comes with a real problem. We want to see a more leveling out of a five-year plan when it comes to builds. We want to see evidence-based decision-making when it comes to these builds as well. When it comes to the mining industry, I really believe we have the ability to unite Yukoners on mining. I think we're the one government that has the respect, and we can forge those conversations and the trust needed in the First Nations community. And also, we've built up a really good rapport with the mining industry as well. So when we're talking about diversifying our economy, Keith, we can't do that against what we have going for us. You know, Yukon is mining. You can't have a Klondike MLA that isn't supportive of the mining industry. So as we are working towards making sure that we have sound environmental considerations in our mining industry, we also want to diversify the economy in other areas as well.
So in terms of diversification, I mean, what actual policies would you put in place, or what would make a difference? Like I said, we keep talking about it, but it never seems to happen.
Yeah, I mean, right now, 14 years later of a Yukon Party government, we're no more dependent, or we're actually more dependent, sorry, on our financial transfers from Ottawa than we were 14 years ago. With the diversification of the economy, it comes from having those conversations so that the builds that we do with our government money, they're logical builds. They make sense for the economies. They make sense for the companies that are in the Yukon right now, whether it be in First Nations communities that are working forward on energy projects, getting them at the table and making sure that that we are providing energy in partnership with the First Nations governments. Great example of diversifying our economy. And that's jobs not necessarily just leaders for First Nations governments. That's jobs for all Yukoners. We have an untested IPP, and we want to work on energy files with First Nations on small hydro projects, on other green areas like geothermal or solar as well.
Let's talk about the other side of the resource industry, oil and gas. Mm-hmm. Now, you've sent a strong signal about fracking. Are you open to conventional oil and gas development?
We absolutely are. We're open to getting back on track with land use planning as well. Keith, as you know, with certainty in the industry, that's where the corporate interests lies. You know, we've been hearing from the mining communities and we've been hearing from the oil and gas industries that they have to be more than just resource industries. They have to have a social lens, and they want to see certainty in where they can and cannot go. Land use planning does that. So we've been very, very vocal that with conventional oil and gas development up in Eagle Plains, that's a land use planned area, and it's an area that's been set aside for industrial use. And this was done through a democratic process of developing a land use plan. The three northern chiefs are in unison with this, and we support that development. We will work with our partner government in oil and gas there. When it comes to fracking, Keith, we've heard from Yukoners a resounding no. I was on the select committee for the risks and benefits of hydraulic fracturing, and at that time I wanted to take a scientific, rational approach to this, as opposed to a political approach. And in doing so, we saw that there was still some environmental concerns with deep well injection of the fracked fluid, the spent fracked fluid. Wellbore integrity is still an issue. But more importantly, the social license just isn't there in the Yukon right now. So a Yukon Liberal government will put a moratorium on fracking, but we do support conventional oil and gas development in those land use planned areas.
And what about areas that have potential, like the Whitehorse Trough for conventional oil and gas? Would you support looking at that through a land use planning process?
Again, it's more of getting the land use planning process back on track. You know, that's where we get the certainty. The next plan up is going to be in Dawson City, I imagine, the Dawson Regional Plan. And I think that that's where that dialogue has to be had. You know, it's one thing for a political party to come out with an ideology and saying we want to have oil and gas, but it's another thing to have great dialogue with all partner governments and with the community to decide what are the logical areas to move forward in and which ones are in need of protection.
Now, speaking of fracking, of course, it's a major part. It's very integral to the current business practices in the oil and gas industry. It's done in BC. Even the NDP government of Alberta permit it. Mm-hmm. What do you guys know about it that, the Premier of Alberta doesn't know?
I think when we went around to all the communities, the big issues were the amount of spent frack fluid. It's the environmental considerations, right? The amount of fluids that are actually coming back to the surface. The science isn't there as to whether or not this fluid stays in place, and also the chemical combinations that are being used. These are areas of concern for Yukoners that we've heard over that two-year process of moving around to all community to community. And again, the education piece is not there. You know, there's a lot of concerns, a lot of misconcerns as well. We did hear a few people, you know, when we went to the communities, misunderstanding the differences between coal bed methane and shale. But again, the social license piece is really important to me. You know, if we're moving forward on major issues, whether it be fracking or oil and gas development in general, I would propose that it would be great to have a referendum on these ideas. Allow the Yukon people to voice their opinion, and then the government is truly representing the communities as opposed to moving forward on political ideologies.
Let's talk about the government's fiscal situation for a minute.
Okay.
Now, of course, the Yukon Premier is usually also the Minister of Finance.
Yeah.
And you were mentioning how the surplus, the accumulated cash in the bank, so to speak, has gone down from a few hundred million to 57 million over the last few years. Also, if you look at the current government's latest financial projections, it shows an actual decline in government spending next year and the year following. And that hasn't happened since the bad old days at the turn of the century when the economy was really slow.
Yeah.
So when you get into office, you'll have some choices about continuing that trajectory of reducing government spending or borrowing, raising taxes, going into deficit. What's your take on that challenge?
Great question, Keith. Again, when you take a look at the piggy bank, Yukon Party 1.0 did a good job of actually putting money in the bank for future endeavors. In the last 2 years, we did spend hundreds of millions of dollars out of that piggy bank. You know, like I said, we went from $225 million to $57 million. So if we're looking at moving forward in past the election cycle where we've spent all of this money to cut some ribbons, it's going to be hard to look into that piggy bank. Now, on the other side of that, we have federal money that's coming for infrastructure spending, and the federal government is offering it at 3 to 1. Basically, for every $1 that we put in, the federal government will give $3 for certain infrastructure spending. It would be a real shame, Keith, if we left any of that money on the table. So we don't want to run deficits. It'll be interesting to see, you know, when you form government, you pull the curtain back and you see really the state of the economy, and you can make a good determination at that point how much money you really have for these types of endeavors. The last thing we want to do is use future federal transfers to pay off the interest for borrowing. That's definitely not something we're interested in. However, if there's going to be a deal such as the federal government's offering right now for $3 for every $1 we put in for certain infrastructure spending, it would be really hard leaving that money on the table.
So it's possible the Yukon might go into debt to match those federal dollars at a 3-to-1 basis, like you were saying.
To maximize the potential for Yukoners in this current climate where interest rates are very low, and with a 3-to-1 option from Ottawa, in those certain circumstances, we would have to consider that. You know, especially because we are in this financial situation. Our federal transfers, they've been increasing every year, but they increase at a decreasing rate. There's been a change in how they figure out the algorithm, and that's affected us. We're happy that the federal government gave $27 million to top up that money after finding out this calculation differential. But when you take a look at all of the scenarios that we're currently in, a negative GDP growth and a forecast as well that is pretty alarming. You know, we've heard from the Premier that it's bad across all the North, but the Canada Conference Board has shown it's bad in Yukon, particularly moving forward. So to me, that is, we need to change the way that we're doing our fiscal planning, and we need to maximize the jobs that stay in Yukon, and we want to keep our money in Yukon, but we still need to take a look at that federal money and make sure we maximize those dollars.
Now, in terms of taxes, the current government has modestly reduced taxes in a couple of their budgets.
Yeah.
Would you continue that trajectory? Would you possibly raise taxes to keep up government spending to stimulate the economy?
Yeah, we're in no interest in raising taxes. We want to reduce business taxes for Yukoners, absolutely.
So let's talk for a minute about climate change and the environment. You mentioned that earlier.
Yeah.
You know, it looks like the federal government plans, although we don't know for sure what they're going to do, to come up with some kind of policy where each province and territory will have to have a carbon tax. And if they don't have one, the feds will impose one. So what's your take on a carbon tax? Would a carbon tax be good for the Yukon?
I think it's important to state right off the bat, it doesn't matter which political party wins this election in November, there will be a federal tax. The Minister of Climate Change and the Environment has been very clear on this as recently as September 19th, saying that this winter there will be a federal tax. And like you mentioned, Keith, if that jurisdiction hasn't already come up with a plan, well, then they will have a federal plan. So when we take a look at that, we want to make sure that every single dollar collected in the Yukon stays in the Yukon. We also want to make sure that if Yukoners are making less than the average salary, that this will not affect their bottom line. We keep on hearing about diapers. We want to make sure that if you're finding it hard to make ends meet, that this tax is not going to affect you. We want to be able to give that money back directly, not to the Yukon government, but to Yukon people.
Now, the federal government has a long history of coming up with ideas that they think are great for the whole country, but which certain regions don't like. So you wouldn't fight the federal government on this with Brad Wall of Saskatchewan. You would accept the federal diktat and then figure out how to make it as optimal as possible for the Yukon afterwards?
I look at it as a federal government won a national majority government based on a few different policies and planks. And To sit here and think that we're going to change that, I'd rather put my energy towards coming up with a solution for an inevitability. We remember when the GST came in. There was lots of jurisdictions that fought the GST, but this was a federal tax, and it was campaigned and implemented. So we could stomp our feet and we can cross our arms and say no, no, no. But really, we could spend that time with open, honest dialogue, respectful dialogue with Ottawa, talk with the communities, talk about the different cases and how a carbon tax would affect local businesses, how it would affect the differences between really northern Yukon communities and ones that are closer to the center, and come up with a plan that works for Yukoners, as opposed to sticking our heads in the sand.
Now, officials can design a carbon tax that is revenue neutral so that it's not a net tax grab. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned compensating low-income people. Maybe they don't pay enough income tax for that to, for reductions there, so you can make it up to them. What about the mining industry? You know, placer miners in Dawson, there's they burn so much diesel. Or large mines that might be opening up here burn a lot of fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. How are you going to compensate them, or will you? Or will it just be, you know, the fact that a placer miner in Dawson will end up paying a lot of money and a bicycle riding environmentalist in downtown Whitehorse will get a check back in the mail?
I think it's an important point that this tax is about stewardship. You want to, the whole point of a carbon tax and becoming part of a low carbon economy is making sure that we can transition into alternative fuel uses. So that's what that tax does. So whether you're a person living in Whitehorse or a person living up in the goldfields in Dawson, it's about triggering their thoughts towards becoming a little bit more efficient with their uses. Again, we would like to see local businesses prospering from this tax where international or national businesses won't. So we want to make sure that whatever we do when we work with the partner governments to come up with a plan, to come up with a solution, to keep that money in the Yukon, that it will affect the locals the least, and we'll put a lens on people that come up and use our resources but don't stick around, and try to use that as a mode to creating a made in Yukon solution to an international dilemma.
And what do you say to the people that will end up as losers of this, that'll be on the wrong side of the average, where it'll be a big chunk out if they're in the trucking, local trucking business or placer miners or other people that burn a lot of diesel? They're going to be making, you know, quite a big contribution to other Yukoners.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I would say that this is a federal tax, and that federal tax is evenly hitting people right across Canada. You know, we want the federal government is making a point that you have to have a national price. That national price is set at a certain standard. We, as a local government that care about our local transportation companies and care about our placer miners, are going to make sure that that effect is minimalized as much as possible.
Let's talk for just 1 minute about First Nations relations. What would a Liberal government do differently than the current government?
I think it's what we've been doing already. The last 5 years, I've been spending a lot of time getting to know the chiefs and councils, getting to know the economic development branches of all of the different First Nations, getting to know CASCA and unsigned First Nations, and dealing with the issues and concerns on a community-to-community, chief-to-chief, citizen-by-citizen basis. And in doing so, you know, we're seeing that there's an antiquated approach right now to how we're doing our mining industry. I mean, right now, Keith, we have a government that is working on a mine licensing initiative, improvement initiative, and also a mineral development strategy. And really, both of these things are to solve the problems that we currently have. And one of the biggest problems is we have a government that's not respecting the treaty rights of our Aboriginal governments. So they need to be at the table when we're talking about land use planning, when we're talking about resource development. You know, when you sign on to self-governing agreements, you're taking traditional territory and setting it up for everybody to discuss, and the compromise there is to be at that table for those conversations. As we move forward on these two new initiatives, the First Nations still aren't at the table. So I think a Yukon Liberal government is going to do what the other two governments can't. We have the rapport in the mining community. We also have the rapport with inside the First Nations government. It's the proof is in our candidates. We have a couple of chiefs that are running for us. We have decades and decades of experience, folks from the Aboriginal community that have done years and years of drawing down on self-governing agreements, that have worked with inside their own governments to move forward logically with the treaties, and you know, they've trusted us to come into this government and to work hand in hand, partnering for the betterment of all Yukoners.
Thanks, Andy. Let's wrap up with the big money question for the election, for the voters on election day.
Okay.
Why should Yukon voters elect you and a Yukon Liberal government? Give us your pitch.
I think we can best manage the economy. You know, again, with the First Nations relations and mining, it's a very important piece, Keith. This is one of the biggest things that make Yukon Yukon is our mining and our resource industries. We want to maximize the potential for locals, and we also want to make sure that First Nations governments are hand in hand in that process, being the stewards of the land and ensuring that we're going to have seven generations of jobs. But also, more importantly, our government is not based upon an ideology. You know, we are interested in forming a government that works for all Yukoners, not just those to the left, not just those to the right. We honestly believe that you can have the environment and the economy in one sentence, and I think we're the best government for that.
Well, Thanks very much for joining us, Sandy. It was a real pleasure.
Yeah, thank you very much, Keith, for your time. Appreciate it.
Hello, Frank. Thanks for joining us from Faro today over Skype.
Well, it's a pleasure to be.
For those of you who don't know Frank, he has a Bachelor of Arts from the University of Western Ontario and a Bachelor of Education from the University of Ottawa. He's a former leader of the Ontario Green Party and ran for them, among other things, in the 2011 federal election in Ontario and most recently in the 2015 federal election here in the Yukon. And he's currently a teacher in Faro. So Frank, with this election coming up in the fall, what would you say the top two or three issues facing the Yukon in this election are?
Well, I'd say top of the list is climate change. We're the scientific community around the world is sort of getting very serious and warning us that we could be facing catastrophic climate change effects in the next number of decades. So I think finally that message is getting through to the citizens of the world and the governments of the world. And Yukon is lagging on that department. Canada is a serious laggard. And the federal liberals are starting to make some steps in the right direction, but it's still pretty pale. So the Green Party would like to see some serious advances and an action on that in terms of a revenue neutral carbon tax.
And the Green... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Well, did you want me to go through three of them?
Yeah, I know that the Green Party, some people think it's all about the environment, but I know that you have extensive platforms on all the issues facing government today. So your other two or three issues would be great to know about too.
Well, of course, every political party has one emphasis, and then they have a full range of platform issues, and the Green Party is one. I mean, the old argument with the Green Party is if we don't have a viable planet, then everything else is academic. We won't have an economy. We won't have good health. We won't have industry. We won't have manufacturing. You know, the primacy of the planet is top of our list. And then, of course, but to have a more functional democratic system, electoral system, very dear to the Green Party's heart and benefiting all Yukoners and Canadians is to have a system of proportional representation where the electoral vote of a party is matched by the number of MLA seats in the legislature. That's very important to us, and the federal Liberals are promising something there, and we'd like Yukon to follow suit. And a third one for us, of course, is we'd like to see some serious change in the legislation towards the Catholic education system, because presently, unless you're a Catholic, you can't get a job for the public jobs that are the available jobs that are in the Catholic system. You know, it just boggles my mind, the lack of moral fiber on the part of Sandy Silver and Liz Hansen and Daryl Pawlowski to allow this legislation to exist. It's so prejudicial against teachers in Yukon that are not allowed to apply for these jobs that are publicly funded. It's bizarre. It's beyond my capacity to understand and explain.
So let's talk about what a green premier and a green government would do on each of these topics. So with regard to Catholic education, which parts of the law would you change and what would the new system look like?
First of all, all teachers and educational professionals should be able to work for all publicly funded teaching and education jobs in Yukon. So that has to change right away. But also, Green Party can't understand why a jurisdiction like Yukon, which is a secular jurisdiction, the Green Party position is we have no business funding a religious education in Yukon. You know, people have to drive past two or three schools to get to their school. So it's a green issue in that it would save a lot of fossil fuels and time and stress if you could go to your local school. So that's we'd like to see that changed.
And what would democratic reform look like under a green government? Have you thought through for sure if you would go to a proportional representation or preferential voting or what the future system might look like in the Yukon?
Yes, we have thought about that a lot. And what we would like to see is a very serious discussion, which Canada is starting to have and Yukon is having as well. Instead of just defining what the Green Party would like, we'd like everyone to make a good decision on that. But our preference, of course, is mixed member proportional representation. The ridings would stay exactly the same, and there would be, as you know, a small number of extra seats, list seats are put on, which will help towards proportionality. So it wouldn't be very disruptive. And the system is in place right now in Germany and New Zealand, where every voter would vote twice. They vote once for the local members, just like now. It's really important to have a local person representing you. And then you'd vote the second time for the party of your choice. So let's say you really like the local member and he happens to be a conservative or a liberal or so, but you like the Green Party, then you could vote for the local conservative and the Green Party as your choice. And then the percentage of vote that the party votes get, the second vote, would be top, members would be added to the legislature to make up proportionality. It's a very non-invasive way of improving the system with very little effort and very little change for most people.
So Frank, let me make sure I understand that. The current 19 members of the legislature would stay as they are, representing their ridings. But then in addition, there'd be a pool of additional MLAs that would be elected because, maybe two Greens, because the Greens got a certain percentage of the vote, maybe a third or a fourth party on top of those 19. Is that right?
That is correct. So the size of the legislature would expand to some extent, you know, depending what people feel like, 5 or 10 seats extra. But the 19 would be elected just like now. But then the second vote that people have, they have two votes. If they, say, gave the party 5 or 10% of the vote, then we would get one or two of those extra MLAs. And the other parties, if they already had their percentage, they wouldn't receive those extra MLAs. That's the way it works in Germany and New Zealand. Ironically, it was the Allies that imposed that system on Germany after the Second World War because they knew it was the best system. And they didn't want to have artificial majorities in Germany, like we have artificial majorities in Canada and the U.S. But so this system was good enough for Germany, but it wasn't good enough for Canada. That's the irony of the situation.
Let's talk about climate change and carbon taxes for a minute. So nationally, the Liberal government is talking. We don't know exactly what they'll do yet, but there's some talk that they will impose a national carbon pricing scheme. If a local province or territory has a system, that'll be acceptable. If a province or territory doesn't have one, they'll impose one. What would a Green government in the Yukon do in terms of a carbon tax? What would your policy look like?
Well, I think it would be much like what the British Columbia has at the moment. British Columbia now has a carbon tax, and all the money goes to, some of it goes to people who are carbon poor, sort of thing, energy poor, the poor people who can't afford and shouldn't be taxed extra. And then others goes to fund some green technologies in British Columbia. But a lot of it, the majority of it, goes to reduce other income taxes. The main point that we'd like to get through that some politicians refuse to accept is that a carbon tax is not an additional tax, not a new tax. It's a revenue neutral tax shift. So the Green Party would like to see for every dollar collected through the carbon tax, it would all get paid back to the citizens of Yukon dollar for dollar in an equal percentage to every adult. So you can choose whether you are going to save money or not by going green. Because if you live greener, you still get the same payment as everyone else. So it's a very good incentive to businesses. It's also nice to get a check or a direct deposit in your bank account once a month, which will remind you every month that if you go green, you still get that same payment, but you won't be paying the tax.
Now, it'll be such a system would be revenue neutral, as they say, on average, in that the money raised would be paid back to Yukoners. But within that, there might be winners and losers. Let's take placer miners in Dawson, for example, with those 900-liter diesel tanks on their cats. They would be paying a lot of carbon tax, and that might be bad for the placer mining industry, or indeed, if you had a big mine starting in the Yukon that used fossil fuels. What do you say to the Yukoners that are concerned that a carbon tax would hit our mining industry hard, and we don't have that many other options for jobs?
Well, I suspect that the placer mining industry, like any industry, can take steps and technologies to improve their efficiency. And the carbon tax will encourage everyone through a market mechanism to choose the greenest technologies available. So I think the placer industry or any mining industry should face the same charges as anyone else, because we have to have a fair system. We shouldn't start making exemptions, and everyone can go green as much as possible, and they can avoid those taxes. That's the whole idea behind it.
Let's talk for a minute about the economy in general. You know, jobs are important to voters. It often appears as a top thing when they're polled about what's on their mind as they think to vote. Beyond a carbon tax in the mining industry, like we were just talking about, what would a Green government do differently to foster economic development in the Yukon?
Well, Greens are not really into subsidize. We don't like subsidizing this and subsidizing that, because what you do when you subsidize, you're taxing successful businesses and successful people to subsidize non-successful businesses and non-successful people. So we don't like the tax and spend approach to economics, but we are tax shifters. We'd like to shift the taxes off of people, off of businesses, and onto nature. The revenue neutral tax shift off of jobs and businesses and onto nature will preserve the beautiful resources, the beautiful nature that we have in Yukon, because as soon as you put a tax on something, businesses and people will use it more sparingly. And it's the same idea with the carbon tax. It's a privilege, not a right, to use resources. It's a privilege, not a right, to pollute. So you should pay for the privilege of emitting carbon, and you should pay for the privilege of using resources, which belong to all of us and to future generations and to other species. But if you have a job, you shouldn't be taxed on that job. You know, a person studies hard and finally gets a job, and the government says, great, you have a job, now we're going to start taxing you. That's not a good idea. If you earn money, you should be able to keep that money. But if you want to use the resources that belong to all of us, you should compensate the rest of us through green taxes or carbon tax. That's the fairest way of creating more jobs, because people will be less expensive to employ, and nature will be more expensive. So businesses will hire more people and use resources more efficiently. That's the goal.
So Frank, does this mean that you would possibly increase carbon taxes even higher than BC, the current 7 cents a liter, around $30 a ton, and go even farther in the Yukon so you could reduce taxes further on incomes and other things that we use?
Yes, we'd start at $30 a ton, but it would go up $10 a year per ton. Economists say that the carbon tax doesn't have any effect until it's up to about $100 a ton. So that'll take us 7 more years to get there. But it doesn't hurt one jurisdiction over another if they have a higher carbon tax. It reduces income tax, or you get a direct payment in your bank account. So it doesn't impact you disproportionately. Also, at the border, you can have border adjustment taxes for products coming in that are high carbon taxes, and you can give exemptions to products going out that are low carbon, have a carbon footprint. So it can be adjusted at the border, and it's beneficial to everyone. And we have to be very careful and make sure we take care of this planet. Otherwise, you know, what kind of legacy are we leaving our young people?
Let me ask you some questions that we've also asked the other leaders. One is on fiscal policy. You know, what is the Green Party's approach to taxation in general, to debt, and to deficits? The Yukon government used to have around $200 million of money in the bank. That's now down to $57 million as the current government's been spending on infrastructure and capital budgets. The Yukon government budget is expected to go down next year and the year after. Where would the Green Party take us on that question?
Well, as everyone knows, it's a two-stage thing. There's infrastructure, which can be amortized after a number of years. So an infrastructure investment now can be more expensive, but an operating budget should be balanced, obviously. And even the infrastructure budget should be, you know, calculated to be amortized over, you know, 10 or 20 years sort of thing. But the Green Party, we do not like going in debt. We do not like having deficits, and we'd like to eliminate debts, because when you're paying interest rates on your debt, there goes your operating capital. So we'd like to, we are not a tax and spend. We don't like subsidizing. We don't like going into debt. What we like doing is tax shifting. We'll get the taxes off of people so that people are less expensive to employ, and shift those taxes onto nature. So nature is a little more expensive. There will be winners and losers, but if you go green and you use less nature and hire more people, your business will be successful. And that's exactly the kind of business we need for the future.
Well, Frank, let's wrap up with the big money question. Why should Yukoners vote for you and the Green Party in the upcoming election?
Well, the Green Party, by definition, we see the world through the ecological worldview, the ecological paradigm. If humans are biological beings, we exist courtesy of the life support systems on this planet. And if our industrial activity and our lifestyles diminishes the capacity of the planet to support human life, then we are serious quality of life for future generations. That's why the Green Party came into being, is to usher into the electoral system the ecological worldview. Like, you can't vote for Greenpeace, you can't vote for David Suzuki, even though I'd like to. So we have to make sure our governments are cognizant and sensitive enough to do the kind of tax shifting we need to turn our economy green. Right now, our economic system fights our ecological system. So we got to get the economic system working in concert with our ecological goals so that they're in concert, so that they work together and we end up with a green planet. We need carbon neutral as much as possible, and we have to be very careful about toxic chemicals, et cetera, of course. So that's the Green Party's purpose of existence, is to get the economy into harmony with our planet, with the environment. And we need to do that in Yukon, just like we need to do it in Canada and all over the world.
Frank, thanks very much for joining us by Skype today. We appreciate it. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you very much, Keith. Bye-bye.
Michael, thanks for coming down to join us today.
My pleasure.
As chair of the Yukon Chamber of Commerce, what do you and your members think is the number one issue facing Yukoners in the election coming up this fall?
It's really about creating the environment where our economy can prosper, and there's a lot of work that we have to do on that front. In the Yukon, we have a tremendous amount of potential, not just in terms of resources and our spectacular wilderness, but Yukoners themselves. We have tremendously innovative people who are doing some really incredible things. And we need to put some effort into creating that environment so that people who want to do things that ultimately benefit the Yukon have the certainty that they need, are able to go after those opportunities and do those things that benefit us all.
Now, politicians have been talking for many years in past elections also about the need to diversify the economy and also support the resource industry, but it never quite seems to happen. What are a couple of tangible things that the next government of whatever political stripe could do to help the economy?
We need to bring Yukoners together to start talking about these problems. To think that one political party or another is going to solve the problem is not really realistic. We have the answers collectively, and that's one of the strengths that we have as a territory, is that we are small. We are able to come together, and we are able to look at these things and come up with solutions that work for the territory. We need to do that.
So you think some way to bring together First Nations businesses, non-First Nations businesses, Yukon Chamber, Whitehorse Chamber, different stakeholders to talk about the economy would be the thing to do?
Absolutely everybody. People who are working, people who aren't working, people who run their own businesses, people who work for the government, people who are staying at home. Everybody should have a say in how we develop the Yukon in the future.
And what's your point of view on the outlook for the mining industry? There's various reports out there with positive and less positive forecasts. What's your take from you and your membership?
Regardless of what happens with the industry, whether commodity prices rise or continue to rise or fall, we need to make sure that the fundamentals are there so that the industry has a platform to grow upon. It is an important part of the Yukon's economy. We have to make sure that it is done right. And part of that means that if there's infrastructure that's needed, we should look at how we develop that infrastructure. We can get creative about how we develop that infrastructure. We need to make sure that our regulatory regime balances the need for protecting the environment and the benefit of Yukoners with the ability for these companies to have some faith and certainty in the process so that they can actually develop their projects.
Now, there's potentially some big infrastructure dollars out there from Ottawa and from the Yukon government. What should they prioritize? Mining roads, electricity systems, internet cables, all of the above? What would your take be?
Definitely connectivity is a major priority for the Yukon. When the internet goes down, we all suffer from it, and it doesn't matter which industry you're a part of. When it comes to infrastructure like roads or electricity, we all need that. It's more than just mining companies that can benefit from mining access roads. We do need to develop them carefully. We do need to develop them appropriately. But prioritization, internet first, and we have a lot of work that we need to do in terms of our electricity and our transportation systems. There's just a lot of work that needs to get done.
Now, during the campaign itself, speaking personally, what are your plans? What are you going to do during the election?
I'm going to meet the candidates in my riding, and I'm going to talk to each and every single one of them and find out how well they'll represent my riding and how well they'll represent the Yukon, and then I'll vote for the candidate that I think will do the best job.
Michael, thanks very much for joining us today.
Thank you, Keith.
Lynn and Paul, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
From the point of view of the First Nations Chamber of Commerce, what do you think the number one most important issue facing Yukoners in this election is?
I think at this current time, looking at the economic conditions, we've seen a number of reports, leading indicators that have come out, both Yukon government economic development, and recently with the Conference Board of Canada, both showing that we're going to have a couple of years of constraint here in the territory. So I think from a global perspective, macro, you know, focusing on the economy is going to be very critical.
Lynn, what do you think?
Well, I think it's partnerships with Yukon First Nations. I think we have a lot to offer this territory. And in the past, I would say, I think there were a few problems. But I also have to say, it's going our way and things are going really well. I just think we could do a lot better. And procurement really is an issue for us as well.
You were mentioning procurement earlier. Could you tell us a bit more?
Paul and I have been in a few meetings on that. And I think Paul can speak to that a little more with government.
Certainly. So, I mean, I think, you know, looking at procurement, you know, again, with those economic indicators, you know, we have to really be focused on ensuring that we're engaging local businesses, First Nations businesses, ensuring that they have a meaningful contribution within that. So, you know, around that procurement, inclusion, for local businesses, looking at how we're tendering, the timeliness of those tenders within the construction season. All of that is going to be a big factor. We've seen several mines that have dropped off here in the territory. We don't have a lot of levers to pull right now, and I think a big lever that's a success for us over the next couple of years is really going to be around that piece.
Now, how big exactly or estimated is the Yukon First Nations business community, and what can a future government of whatever political stripe do to support it?
Well, we've had some great talks with all of the leaders recently, and we think that they're understanding that we are a huge contributor to the Yukon's economy. Collectively, we see ourselves having cash of probably $500 million. If you add our assets to that, the Northern Visions, Air North, those type of things, we're easily $750 million. We need partnerships. We need jobs in Yukon. We need procurement here that can really, you know, bring our capital home. We're out on the markets like everyone else, but there's a territory that we could invest in. We just need the right investments.
Absolutely. You know, I think, you know, one point to that story, Keith. I was recently in Alaska, and we have business over in Alaska. And obviously with the downturn in oil, we were a little bit concerned about what does the future hold in that state. And a couple of the comments I got back from people that are well-versed within the Alaskan economy, they said, it will not be as bad as we've had historically. And the number one factor for that is due to the Aboriginal development corporations in Alaska have diversified and become such a meaningful part of that economy that they are actually going to take the sting out of those oil price collapse.
Well, thanks. $750 or $500 million is a very big number in an economy our size.
Huge, and I think it can be a lot bigger, right? I mean, there needs to be an opportunity where we can have greater meaningful impact, right, and involvement.
Now, on the personal front, with the election coming up, what are you two planning to do during when the writ gets dropped, as they say?
Well, I'm going to try not to be glued to the TV or the debates, but definitely we want to make sure that First Nations are first and foremost in the conversation. We can't keep going like this. We are a contributor to the economy. We need to be a part of it.
Yeah, we'll be focused in ensuring that the First Nations voice is heard, you know, the business voice, and focus on operating our companies.
Well, thanks very much, Lynn and Paul, for sharing a point of view from the First Nations Chamber of Commerce. Thanks
we
for coming out.
We appreciate it. Thank you.
Dave, thanks for joining us today.
Keith, thanks very much for having me.
So the Yukon's going into a big election this fall. From your point of view as chair of the Energy Committee of the Yukon Chamber of Commerce, what's the number one issue facing Yukoners in this election?
Well, I think it's growth of the private sector economy. To me, that's the most important issue. For businesses to have the opportunity to develop and grow in the Yukon. And we've seen an economy that's dominated by the public sector. And there's a lot of government, and I think there's tremendous opportunity to grow the local economy and provide opportunities for local businesses. And I think another key is participation of First Nations in the growth of the private sector economy, and have them embrace some of the opportunities that are out there and fully participate. And in doing so, you know, perhaps be able to make the transition from, say, development opportunities and exploration to getting over the hump into value creation and adding value to the economy.
Now, fracking has been a very controversial topic here. There's a number of candidates for the election that want to have a moratorium here, yet in BC and Alberta, fracking continues as part of business. Mm-hmm. What's your opinion on whether fracking should take place in the Yukon?
Yukon, in my experience, is there's a tremendous resource of traditional, conventional fuels that can be produced now that would have been produced 50 years ago elsewhere, because it's so much less work intensive to produce it. It flows relatively easily out of the ground and can be easily recovered. It's not energy intensive, and in conventional sense doesn't need to be fracked. I think that in the future of technology, things can change substantially, and we've seen a huge sea change in the use of technology to recover hydrocarbons over the last 10, 15 years, and I expect that will continue. So my view of that is that our programs in Eagle Plain are targeting conventional resources, and we think that there's a sufficient conventional resource to make a difference in terms of energy mix within the Yukon. In the future, whether or not fracking occurs in Yukon, to me, is to track changes in technology. And my expectation is that it'll be less of things, less water, less footprint, less disturbance, and I think we need to track that and see how that changes over time, because what it is now is not what it was 40 or 50 years ago, and I expect it'll change again in the future.
Well, Dave, thanks for those answers, and look forward to seeing how the energy issues play out in the election this fall.
Great. Well, thanks very much, Keith.
Don, thanks for coming down to the wharf and joining us today.
You're welcome.
So from the point of view of Yukoners concerned about oil and gas, what do you think the number one issue facing Yukoners in this election is?
I believe and not only I, but a number of Yukoners believe that the number one issue is going to be the protection of our water for today and for the future. And so I think that's a very important issue for a lot of us. That's why we're into this process of what we're trying to do.
Now, the economy's in the doldrums. The mining industry's having a tough time. Tourism is struggling. A lot of people are looking at oil and gas as another opportunity for jobs and for revenues for the Yukon government. Do you think there's a place in the Yukon for an oil and gas industry at some point in the future, or are you completely against it?
Well, I think over 8,000 Yukoners have said no to fracking, mm-hmm. have said no to oil and gas in some ways. If it means fracking, that means they don't want it. Mm-hmm. That's over half of the electorate, if you look at the number of people that vote in the election. And I think the important part, the economy can be in renewables. We do have a window. We find that many countries, many areas are starting to move down that path. Oil and gas is in the doldrums and will be in the doldrums from now on. Climate change is making that big issue one of the things that I think we have to look at.
And what kind of renewables do you think are in the Yukon's future? Would those be more big dams, micro hydro, windmills, all of the above? What do you think?
Well, I think there are a variety. I think our problem is that we've been seduced by the oil and gas industry over the last 100 years, and there has been very little in the sense of trying to look at renewables. Now we're starting to see a real catch-up with a lot of issues coming along with even storage batteries. I think for the Yukon, what we're going to have to do, the transition has to be oil and gas. I don't think we have any issue on that. But as far as oil and gas in the Yukon, forget it. Mainly because most of our geology, even by their own research, their own geology people, it's all shale. And if we're going to take our water and use that in order to extract oil and gas, then we're really working against ourselves. We're working against the future, and we're working against the whole idea of what sustains us, and it's not oil and gas.
Now, some of the folks who are drilling up on the Dempster Highway say they have conventional resources that they want to feed into the Yukon power system. What do you and your group think about that proposal?
I think the conventional is being masked right now with the idea that they're not even going to mention hydraulic fracturing. They're just going to say it's all conventional, and when they get started, it's going to be whatever it takes to get it out. And so that's one of the ploys I think the oil and gas company and the current Yukon government is using. There's no doubt about it, the Liard and also the Cotonili Cotonou-Liard and also the what's happening up in the Eagle Plains area is all shale. And it doesn't matter how conventional they become for the first little while, right, they're going to be right into the hydraulic fracturing because there's no other choice. And that's by their own research, their own studies. So for them to say that this is conventional, and for we, the Yukoners, or some of us Yukoners, who think that we can go along with this idea of sustaining our own oil and gas, where's the refinery? Where is the roads? You know, where is the pipeline? There's no way. It's going to cost $1 billion, if not more, for even a refinery. So what are they talking about? It costs right now $200 million to sort of oil and gas. We're looking at that as an issue because we can do it closer. We can't. We can't do it any closer. You're going to be ending up, we'll have no roads left. And, you know, you will end up with issues that will be far more impacting on Yukon than we have now.
Now, a couple of the big mining projects that are on the drawing board for opening in 5 or 10 years, they plan to use liquefied natural gas from northeastern BC and truck that up to fuel those. And those power plants could be as big as the current electrical plants in the Yukon. What does your group think about those processes? Should that be allowed?
I think what we should do is be creative. And as a government, when you have a government, they should be looking at creative ideas for the future. We know that the current government wants oil and gas because they think that this is going to be an economic driver. All we have to do is look at Alberta. All we have to do is look at BC, Northeast BC, and see what happens. Is this what we want for the Yukon? Or do we want to be different? If companies want to come in here, they'll have to do it on our dime. In other words, what the government sets up. Having oil and gas and having liquefied, you know, natural gas is not going to be the solution, mainly because it's the same thing. And they're going to have to look at what some companies are doing, say, in the Northwest Territories. Dyvek, for example, built 3 huge wind generators to help supplement. They know that they can't do it on its own, so they've got a diesel backup. And so why aren't we being creative there? And then once they leave, the oil company or these mining companies leave, they can give it to the Yukon, because then it's sustainable, it's long term. But we're not thinking out of the box. All we're doing is going down the same oil and gas mentality, which we have to get off of.
Well, Don, thanks very much for coming down and sharing your point of view with us today. We'll see what happens during the election.
Thank you. Thanks, sir. Keith.
I'm here with Kyle Carruthers, a Whitehorse lawyer and newspaper columnist, to talk about the big issues in the upcoming fall election in the Yukon. Hi, Kyle. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Keith.
So in your opinion, what is the number one big issue facing the Yukon in this election?
I personally think that climate change is the big issue facing not just the Yukon, but the whole world. I have small children and I'm still relatively young myself, so I'd like to see the world be here in its present state for the foreseeable future. And frankly, what I've seen in the discourse in the Yukon has been a little bit too much excuse making and not enough action. I mean, this is an issue that's not tomorrow's issue anymore. We've seen the effects of climate change already. And there's a lot of talk about the northern way of life and how things are more expensive up here, which is not untrue at all. There's certainly, you know, different challenges that we face here that aren't faced elsewhere in the country, but I don't think that that is a complete excuse for inaction. And I think that action needs to go beyond the government retrofitting its own vehicles and its own buildings. The message that we seem to be getting from the current government is, we'll take care of this and you guys just go about your life and, you know, don't make any changes to how you do things. And that's really played out in how they've really rejected the idea of carbon pricing, which I think they see as a bit of a wedge issue that they can use against the other parties.
Well, you know, there's a broad scientific consensus, as you know, that climate change is happening and it'll have big effects. But the big question is, what should we do about it? So what do you think the next Yukon government should do on climate change?
I do think that some sort of climate pricing regime is necessary. And frankly, if we don't move on it here, and if they don't move it on at Saskatchewan, we're probably going to see it nationally anyways. And the Premier's expressed a number of times that he wants to see the North's unique circumstances and taken into effect. And by rejecting it territorially, I feel like they're basically inviting the federal government to step into that area. And then we're going to see a regime that maybe doesn't take into account our unique circumstances here.
So how would you see that working? Would that be an extra tax we would pay at the gas pump on home heating fuel, flights to Vancouver, and everywhere we use carbon tax, carbon fuels?
I do think, yes, it needs to be well, relatively broad, and frankly, it is going to have an effect. You know, if you fill up your car, it's going to be more expensive, but there's lots of research showing that those kind of price signals do affect consumer behavior. Now, I do think that, you know, the Yukon government has tons of money. I frankly don't want to be giving them any more, but there's plenty of ways that this could be made revenue neutral, so people have an incentive to reduce their own footprint and, you know, make retrofits, things like that, while not enriching the government coffers. I certainly hear that we don't necessarily need to be giving more money to the Yukon government. I understand that that point, but
so
I think
people might be getting checks back. They would pay the carbon tax at the pump, get a check back that they could spend on anything they want. But what about the people, like, say, the placer miners or the mining industry that use a lot of fossil fuels that might be hit hard by a carbon tax? Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, there's going to be some complicated details that are going to be worked out, and we don't want to hit industry too hard, but we do want them to be part of the solution as well. And wherever they can, you know, reduce their footprint as well, you know, upgrade old equipment, whatever they can do, we'd like to see that done there too.
Well, thanks for sharing your thoughts on your big issue for the election. What are you going to do during the election itself?
Well, I'd probably just be part of the conversation, keep writing my column. I'm a truly undecided voter at this point. I have no idea what I'm going to do when I go to the poll, so just be part of the conversation and do my best to make sure that this issue is gets as much prominence as it can.
Well, thanks. I look forward to reading your column on Wednesday nights. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
That's Kyle Carruthers, Whitehorse lawyer and newspaper columnist.